Hey friends, my name is Cheyenne. I am the artist behind Simply Lettered Studio. I am a calligraphy and engraving artist, and I've had a lot of you express interest in learning calligraphy from me. I do teach in-person workshops, but that doesn't reach everybody, so I am launching a subscription kit. You will receive a calligraphy and lettering lesson each month that has all of the tools and supplies to create a project and complete a lesson, and then you'll have this video tutorial to go with it also each month. This month for January, it is brush calligraphy, but also in our lineup we have glass dip pen, watercolor calligraphy, a pointed pen calligraphy, paint pens, and a lot of fun things planned. I'm also going to be collaborating with a guest artist each month so that you don't just get my style of calligraphy, you get a lot of different styles. So this is definitely the place to be if you want to learn. I'm really excited about what we have in store. If you haven't subscribed yet and you're interested, I offer an annual subscription and a monthly subscription. And then each month, if there's any leftover kits, I'll put a handful up on the website so it's first come, first serve for a one-time purchase. So we'd love to have you join us in our group, and let's get started. All right, so January's kit is all about brush lettering. You have two brush pens included in your kit this month. They are specifically the Marvy Uchida Le Pen Flex. And you want to make sure if you're looking at brush pens that they say flex or flexible so that you know that you can get those thick and thin lines that make the calligraphy really pretty. So that's just what it's going to look like if you buy a full package. In your kit this month, you have the navy and the light blue. And then we also have a dot journal. It's got that craft cover with a hand-stitched spine and then dot pages inside. You're also going to get a set of worksheets. You'll notice these are on a really smooth paper. I'll talk more about that. Lots of tips and tricks. And then I also wanted to point out that I have created these worksheets by hand. I could have pulled them into the computer, you know, in Photoshop and cleaned them up and made them really precise. But I like you to see the variations of it being done by hand, how it's not completely perfect, and also the pressure comparison. So a lot of times when I'm teaching in person, students will ask, you know, like, how, there's no way in the world that this pen is going to make that thick or thin of a stroke. So by showing you the exact pen that you have in your kit, then you can compare the thickness and figure out, oh, I've got to change something so I can get it as thick as she's getting it or as thin as she's getting it. So we have those basic strokes, the minuscule letters, a traditional script of the month, some words for the cover of your journal, and then this pretty whimsical, modern, flourished set of months. And then I've also, like I mentioned, included some different words that you can put on the cover of your journal. You don't have to use these exact words, but there are some options. And then, of course, inside, if you want to use the months that you just practiced, you can use that or however you decide to use it. Additionally, each month you'll receive a heavy-duty art paper. This month is Bristol board, so kind of like a fancy cardstock, but smooth enough and durable enough for display or to put in a frame, however you choose to use it. And then I've lettered the quote two completely different ways with the same pen, just to give you some ideas of how you might lay out your quote. So there's a little sneak peek of what's in the kit this month, and let's go ahead and get started on the lesson. All right, so here I've got our brush pens and a calligraphy pen holder. Brush pens are simply meant to imitate a tool that is going to release ink, such as a paintbrush or this pointed pen nib or something along that line. But the brush pen is handy because the ink's already there, ready to go. So the oblique holder, this flange coming out the left side makes it oblique. It's a metal piece that holds the metal pointy nib that you see. That's the part that you dip the ink into. And I want to show you how when you add pressure to this pointed pen nib, the tines are going to split apart. And this is a Nico G nib if you're curious or new to calligraphy. So you can see how I'm adding pressure and those two separate tines are spreading apart. So I want to show you what that looks like when you add ink. All right, if you're completely new to calligraphy, this is just a Dr. P.H. Martin's India ink. and I'm putting it on the back side of the nib. And then I'm just going to make some little strokes here so you can see. I'm just getting the ink to flow. It's just some little light strokes pulling down, nothing variating there. But you can see here when I add pressure, those tines are spreading apart to release more ink. The more pressure you add, the more ink you're going to get. The less pressure, the less ink. Same as with a paintbrush and same as with your brush pens. It's all about the pressure. So I'm going to do a little compound curve here, and you can see the thick and thin I'm able to create. So thin up, thick down, thin up, thicker down, and it's not super thick, but you can see the variation there, and that's what's going to make your letters and strokes really pretty in your calligraphy. Now with the brush pen, I'm able to do the same thing. The nib is made to be flexible, so when I add pressure, I can get those thick and thin lines. Now this might sound really repetitive, but it's kind of a hard concept to grasp to add pressure to your pen, because a lot of the times you just pick up your pen and start writing. But this is really the key to making your calligraphy really stand out, is being able to get the thinnest possible and the thickest possible. So there's a compound curve. I'm doing thin up, thick down, thin up, thick down. I'm going to zoom in here so you can see it a little bit better. So I'm holding my pen at a 45 degree angle. I want to show you here, when I hold my pen directly upright, I'm not able to stay consistent. It's shaky, and it's just some of the lines are a little bit thinner, thicker, not a consistent pattern. So you can see here now I've made sure that I've got my proper angle, which is about 45 degrees. Wherever you feel comfortable getting the thickest and thinnest line, that's where you want to hold it, but it's around 45 degrees. So you can see when I've got just that happy angle there, I can get the very thinnest and the very thickest lines out of my brush pen. And I'll do this with every brush pen I pick up, because you may have to adjust your angle just a tad depending on how large the nib is. All right, so your paper that you have in your packet here, hopefully you've noticed by now that it is quite a bit smoother. I use the HP LaserJet 32 pound, and the brand isn't necessarily as important as the pound. Basically, the higher the pound, the smoother the paper is. And I've created these with a 5 millimeter spacing. So your baselines and your X heights are 5 millimeters apart. So all of these straight lines are going to be 5 millimeters apart, and then your slant line is going to be at a 55 degree angle. 55 degrees is pretty common in most calligraphy scripts, especially traditionally. A more modern script may just go straight up and down, so you may not always see guidelines on some of the resources you might download, but they are very helpful in creating consistency. So with our first lesson here, we're going to use this 55 degree slant line. I'm going to show you how I kind of like to set up my paper when I'm sitting down. And basically the slant line is pointing directly towards my body. So here's my oblique holder again, and it kind of shows up better when I show you with that. I've picked up my pen holder naturally, and then I'm going to turn my guide sheet so that those slant lines line up with the point of my nib. So rather than rotating my hand, I'm rotating the paper. So again, I picked up my pen naturally, just like you would your regular pencil, and I lined up the tip of my nib with the slant line. So you can see when I pull down, as if I'm writing, it follows directly along that slant line. That way, again, you're not manipulating your wrist to follow the lines. Rather, you're manipulating the paper, so you don't have to adjust that pen hold that you've had for however many years you've been writing with a pen. And so the same with the brush pen, I'm just going to pick it up naturally, and I'm going to follow along the slant line. So if you're a lefty, this is going to be completely opposite. All right, we are going to talk about basic strokes. And basic strokes sound really basic, really boring, But they are the building block to your calligraphy. So I just want to point out that calligraphy is literally the art of drawing letters rather than your handwriting, where you're just going through the motion. We're actually going to be building up each letter with different strokes. So if these boring basic strokes aren't consistent, your letters will never be consistent. So basically, anytime I get a new tool, I'm going to go back to these basic strokes and figure out how to create consistency with that tool. So you see here, our first stroke is an entry stroke. I started at the bottom, light pressure up, and then I'm going to do an overturn. So the bottom or the baseline is where all of your letters and strokes are going to sit or start. And these are all of the basic strokes for the minuscule letters, which are coming up in the lesson. So again, this is an overturn. I'm going to start at the bottom or the baseline, light pressure up, heavy pressure down. Light pressure up, heavy pressure down. Basically, anytime your hand naturally pulls down is when you're going to add pressure. So we had the entry, the overturn. Now we're going to do the opposite, the underturn, which is heavy pressure down, light pressure up. And you're going to start at your X height or that middle line. Heavy pressure down, light pressure up. Always heavy pressure down, light pressure up. The transitioning is going to be where it takes practice. Once you've figured out the pressure, learning to transition smoothly is your next key practice point. And then we have a compound curve. It's light pressure up, starting at the baseline, light pressure up, heavy pressure down, and then transition back to light. So light up, heavy down, light up. Light up, heavy down, light up. Again, those transition points are going to be where you want to focus your practice. And then we have an ascending stem loop. These are going to be the strokes that you find, like in the letter H and B and D. These are going to start in the middle or the X height. There's your baseline. And that middle where the star is your X height. Start in the middle, loop up, heavy down. So light up, heavy down. Light up, heavy down. And then the opposite is your descending stem loop, which is in letters like Y and G. And you're going to start in the middle and drop below the baseline. Heavy down, light up. I'm just squaring the top off there. Heavy down, light up, and squaring the top off again. Totally okay to go back and make those little touch-ups, because the transition isn't always perfect. Okay, and then the last one we're going to look at is the oval, definitely the hardest. So look closely here. I'm going to make what's more like a capital C. I started almost in the middle or kind of like 2 o'clock. And I'm going up, heavy down, up, light. Light up, heavy down, up, light. The reason I do this is because if you start at the top like that, you're never going to get a smooth transition. So you see there, that's never going to transition smoothly from thin to thick unless you start at the 2 o'clock position. All right, I wanted to show you here, if I can zoom in on my nib a little bit, you can see that it's starting to bend one direction because I've been holding it the same way in my hand. So a lot of the times you might see me rotating my pen, and that's simply to get the nib to kind of go back the other direction. So I just rotated it just a little bit. I do that more naturally now, but I do have students ask me, like, why do I rotate my pen? It's just habit because I notice that my nib will start to bend one direction. And then here I'm showing you a smaller oval, which will be used in letters like a D. And you also have a reverse oval, which is starting opposite and going the other direction for letters like a B. I wanted to show you here on the oval, when you connect back on that 2 o'clock point, it's going to be really hard to get that exactly perfect every time. But the good news is is that's okay because this oval is never going to stand alone on its own. It's typically going to have a connecting stroke. So here is like a traditional O where you're going to add that little comma dot right where it connected. So technically you're going to add a little bit of ink over that connecting spot. And then it might be like a letter A where you add the oval and the underturn. And so it covers up that little connection on the O that is just nearly impossible to get perfect. Your packet is going to include a step-by-step key for creating the minuscule or lowercase letters. So for sake of time, I won't show every letter in this video, but feel free to hop over in the Facebook group for any specific letters you wish to see. And then there will be a little section on connecting letters, and then we'll move to the months for practice. I have a traditional script for you to watch, and then the more bouncy, flourished, modern type script. I am going to leave this in real time so you can see stroke by stroke, but feel free to skip to the next section or speed up the playback speed on your end if you want it to go a bit quicker. So you'll notice how slow this actually is compared to regular handwriting or even cursive, and you can hopefully see how I am pausing after almost every stroke versus each letter, and definitely not cursive where I'm going through the entire word without lifting my pen. So you are quite literally drawing the letters versus writing them. Another important note is that my exit strokes are going clear up to that midline. So there I've got the stem loop. I'm going to do an oval, follow through. I go clear up to the midline, clear up to the midline, clear up, and that is so that my next letter or next stroke has something to connect to. And shows it a little bit better. Clear up and then clear back up. Now, if you'll watch here on April, here comes this P. Yikes. You can see how bad my downstroke of my P was off from the slant line. So I just wanted to show you that it's done by hand. It's not perfect every time, but that's just way too inconsistent for me. And I'm going to do it over again. Again with June, I was off that slant quite a bit, so I'm going to do that one again. That follows it much more consistently. Thank you. And I apologize about November, it got a little bit cut off. We'll finish out December and then I will show you 2023. And numbers are typically written 1.5 times the X height. So where your strokes would fit in that first box, numbers are going to be 1 + 1/2, 1.5 times. And that's just for proportion and what's typically done. So this is a traditional copper plate type script, not 100% as detailed as true copper plate, but very, very traditional. And now I'm going to show you a more modern bouncy script, maybe a little more whimsical. You can see that it's still going to be very consistent. As you lose your consistency, that's when things start to look messy. And then I also did this section with a capital letter, just so you have an example for a capital. But capitals are kind of a whole nother lesson within itself. So just for the purpose of the months, I wanted to provide you a capital. You can see that I'm staying mostly within the guidelines here. Let me finish out January and then we'll look at February. So the way that I make it bouncy is I like to return to my baseline. I like to keep that baseline in mind. And then right there on the U, you can kind of see when I went up, I stretched it just a little above. And when I went down, I stretched it just a little below. Same with the A, just a little above and a little below. So that sounds kind of tricky, but that's the best way I've been able to explain it, is when your hand naturally moves up, instead of stopping right there on that rigid baseline or that rigid midline, stretch it just a little bit up or stretch it just a little bit down to give it that bouncy look. And I don't always bounce every letter. That's how I stay consistent, is you've got to keep something on the baseline so that you have something to go off of. So I'll just leave this here for you to watch. And if you're practicing, you can trace right on the paper over the ones that I've done for you. And another good way is also to use tracing paper to lay over top of this worksheet and practice directly on the tracing paper. And I don't really necessarily love this December the way I flourished it, but I will fix that on your printout for you. So you can clearly see how structured and consistent that traditional script is versus this more whimsical, bouncy, very modern and flourished look. Both very beautiful, and I use them all, you know, with different projects, and they each have their own place, but I wanted to provide you with two different ways that you could write the months of the year. All right, now that you've done some practicing with your letters and your months of the year, you might be ready to try out the cover of your pocket journal. And I've done a few words that you might enjoy putting on the cover, but of course it's going to be completely up to you. So I've got just a scratch paper here. And I've just drawn a baseline. I didn't draw like completely guidelines. If you're more comfortable with the guidelines, definitely use those. I just wanted to show you in a video what some ideas might be. And these aren't the only ideas, of course. If you want to put something else on your journal cover, definitely do that. Or you can ask in the Facebook group as well to see any certain words. And then definitely share with us how you decide to decorate the cover of your journal. And if you put the months inside, I'd love to see what you do with those as well. And here I'm just doing a block script. I like to pair this a lot with calligraphy. They just go so well together. And you can see a little bit how I'm using my brush pen to create a thick and thin, still doing it on the downstrokes. And there's just some different ways to write goals. And then maybe notes. And I don't really love that N. I didn't bring it all the way down like I should have. So the journal is made out of craft paper, and it is a rougher craft paper. You can definitely sketch with your pencil on there. Just go very lightly so that you can erase it well. I do this a lot, but if you're using a light colored brush pen, the pencil can show through. Where we have this navy, it's not going to show, but just be aware of that for future projects that you use. And some of you might ask, well, is this going to ruin my brush pen? It is rough. If I was writing on, you know, like 100 of these, it would definitely ruin my brush pen. But to do one or two words is going to be okay. And while we're talking about ruining your brush pen, that's why we have this smooth paper to practice on. Because if you're practicing, you definitely want to use your smooth paper, or the tips are going to fray. Or, you know, if you're using this craft paper for a project, you might want to have a backup pen in case your pen starts to fray and just not working as precise as when you first got it. So one or two words is going to be fine on this rough paper. And then I wanted to mention about flourishing here as I finish this flourish on the end. The typical guideline for flourishing is to not cross two thick lines. So thin crossing thin looks okay, thick crossing thin looks okay, but when a thick crosses a thick, it starts to look jumbled and just kind of mushed together. And so that's just kind of the general guideline. You don't want to cross two thick lines. Of course, my camera died, but I just added 2023 above the G there. It would also fit nicely over below the S. But any way you want to do it is great too. That's just an idea I came up with. And then inside is the dot pages. It's really smooth, so you shouldn't have to worry about your brush pen. And then these are nice small brush pens, so they work well with this size of book or size of paper. And you can do your months. You could do a whole bullet journal, however you want to do. I love dot paper, and I've linked the Rhodia dot pad because it's just really nice to practice with. If you compare it to like a grid paper or graph paper, that gets really busy, and it's kind of hard for me to focus on my letters because there's just too much going on with the paper. And sometimes the guidelines can be the same way. It starts to get a little overwhelming. So I love the dot paper as you progress because it's just enough to practice with, where you have those dots to kind of keep you, you know, consistent, but it's not too hectic that you can't really figure out what's going on. So I love dot paper. And again, I'll link that Rhodia pad because it is one of my favorites to practice with. So definitely just have fun with this and share with us how you decide to lay out your journal. Can't wait to see it. All right, for the quote, this is quite the process, but I wanted to take you through my whole process. So we have our two pens. I have just a Ticonderoga pencil. I love to keep them handy because they have a nice eraser. I have the Tombow Sand Eraser, which I love. And I'm just going to take you through my whole thought process. So again, if you don't want to watch this in real time, definitely speed it up. Or go ahead and skip to the next section or the next quote if you like that one better. And then we have our Bristol board that we will be creating the quote on. And I did want to show you where I pull my quotes from when I'm just doing a project or something like this. This is the Forbes Book of Business Quotations, and they come from the back of the Reader's Digest. I don't know if you've ever seen this, but it has like those thoughts of life in the very back. And so they've pulled all those quotes into this giant book, and it has every section you could ever imagine. So for January, what I did, I just went and looked at the different topics, and I thought ambition would be a great one for January, a new year, new goals, that sort of thing. So I looked under ambition and I found one that stood out to me. And the one that I found was this one by William Shakespeare. Let's see, where was it? There it is. The one by William Shakespeare. The very substance of the ambitious is merely the shadow of a dream. So once I've found my quote, I'm just going to kind of sketch it out. This is just a piece of scratch paper. I'm just going to do the very substance of the ambitious is merely the shadow of a dream. So the words that are standing out to me are substance, ambitious, maybe merely, not meh, not, and then shadow, and then dream. So I'm kind of like, definitely substance, definitely ambitious, definitely dream, and then maybe something with shadow. We'll kind of see where I go from here. All right, I'm going to just set that to the side and lay it over here. And I'm going to do this one a little more classic script for you. I'm not sure yet. I want to flourish it, so I kind of just leave the skeleton out. And the skeleton meaning I'm not going to do like any of the crossbars. I'm just kind of going to leave that hanging there until I decide how I want to do this, because I kind of have something in mind, but not completely sure yet. So we definitely start with pencil. And there's going to be a lot of erasing and figuring it out, and we'll go from there. All right, I'm going to speed this pencil part up just so you can see the process in my sketching. Thank you. All right, I think I've got it ready to ink mostly how I like it. I'm going to take my Bristol board. I'm going to show you a couple different ways you can do your final piece. All right, so I've got my draft, and we're going to do this first one with a light pad. So what the reason I like to use a light pad is because it's going to eliminate the excess pencil markings and all the erasing. Sometimes you don't have that luxury because you're doing a really large piece, or just for various reasons. But if you can use a light pad, it's going to be really handy. Okay, so I went ahead and centered my draft under the Bristol board. You can use a little piece of washi tape if you'd like to. Also, I am using the Cricut light pad, and I'll link it below and also in your resources. But I just wanted to point out that I love this one because it's really thin. That means that your arm is not going to have like a drop off on the edge over there. Because it's so thin, so that's really nice. All right, so I sped this up because I'm just basically tracing over my sketch. I did actually turn the light pad off just because it's just being a little wonky with the filming. So ideally, you know, your light pad's on, you're just simply tracing over your sketch now that you've had it. I did turn the light pad off, like I mentioned, and I'm just looking at my draft and laying it out. And then I'm just going to go back and touch up, kind of square the edges off, and maybe add in any flourishes in the empty space, and just kind of touch up everything I want before I'm ready to display it. And then last, I wanted to show you how I use that fancy ink sand eraser from Tombow. And I'm zooming in here. Hopefully you can see that little smudges right there by the and in the bowl of the S, that center of the S. The sand eraser is meant to remove ink. So there you go. There you have it. Look how amazing. I always have one of these handy because I am literally the most impatient person waiting for stuff to dry. And I always have a smudge. So it's really nice to just remove the ink. Okay, so for the second version of the quote, we're going to pair some different script. Same process, but without the light pad. I'm going to draft directly on the Bristol board. Just if you don't have a light pad, this is how you do it. This is how I did it for a long time. And then you'll ink it, let it dry really good. And then you can go back and erase all the pencil lines. So I'm going to do some mixed scripts, kind of like a block print, and then a more just typical calligraphy script. So I'm just going to pencil my idea here. I'm just looking at it and I'm noticing that it's slightly off center. So personally, I'm not going to erase the entire thing. I'm just going to kind of mark that, okay, this all needs to be shifted this way just a tad when I go back and ink it. All right, and I'm going to go over everything with my navy pen. I'm just using a consistent thin pressure on this block script. You could add pressure on your downstrokes, however you decide to do it. I wanted to show you one quick way that you can change up your block script, and that's simply by moving the position of your crossbar. So the one that you see on my piece, the crossbars are right there in the middle. And then this one I'm writing right now, the crossbars are moved lower versus this one where I'm writing of the crossbars are moved higher. And it creates just a very different look. Okay, now that I've erased everything, I'm going to go back with my lighter blue and add some highlighting. And I just want to point out again, I've already erased my pencil lines. That's because once I go over it with this light blue, the pencil still shows through these lighter colors and you can't erase it. So make sure you've erased all of your pencil lines and then you can go back with the lighter color and add a shadow. So you kind of want to think of where your light's coming in. Right, you could picture the sun shining down from the upper left corner, and I'm going to add a shadow. Oh, I said that wrong. It would be on the upper right corner, shining down on my letters, and I'm going to add a shadow on the back side of all my strokes just to give it some depth. And it looks really nice. So just where it doesn't matter which side you add it on, just make sure you're consistent. Again, always consistency in all of these different things we're doing. All right, so that I've finished the highlighting, I'm gonna use my sand eraser again and go back and remove any smudges. And you can see we have a very classy script with flourishes and then also the modern type script paired with block lettering and shadowing. Two very different styles, still turned out really lovely. So definitely share in the Facebook group how you decide to lay out your quote and then put it up somewhere all month for you to see. And then you guys can help me choose the February quote. And we'll be having a guest artist who will show us her style in lettering the quote that month. So that will be exciting. If you have watched clear to the end, don't forget that each subscriber is entered into the monthly giveaway. And you could earn additional entries by tagging and sharing your process and your creations and what you do with this month's kit on social media. So here's a little sneak peek at the giveaway. And if you're watching this and you're not a subscriber, we would love to have you join us. We have a private Facebook group that we have a lot of fun in. And just a lot of creating and calligraphy and lettering. You can definitely check the website and see if there's any of these January kits left. And if not, definitely sign up for the following month so that you can join in on the fun. Thanks for watching, guys.